In the last three-style video, I showed you how to do corner twists and edge flips one at a time. But here, I'll teach you how to do multiple twists or flips at once. I'll also talk about breaking into flips and twists and floating buffer, which both make your solves more efficient. We'll start off with twisting two corners, and again, the three-style learning sheet is linked in the description, which has every case listed in there, but you shouldn't learn them as algorithms. This video shows you the logic behind how each of those work, but if you're ever stuck, you can go check. A two twist in the U layer is the same as I showed in the previous video. Just bring the one to UFR that has white in front and twist it this way. Then bring the other one over and twist it with the reverse moves. Then restore the U layer. A two twist in the D layer is exactly the same, but upside down. So I can take this one and twist it this way, and then D2 and twist this one the other way. A two twist in U and D is done with two commutators that have a cancellation in between, and the way I like to think about it, which makes it easier for me, goes like this. I mainly focus on the bottom layer piece, and if it's one of the front two, it goes to UFR. If it's one of the back two, it goes to UBR. First, I work on the side that's not yellow, then I work on the side that is yellow. So the side that is not yellow, first I move it up to here. Then I move the other twisted corner to the same spot, and then move it back down. Next, I'll work on the side that was yellow. So then I'll move this one up, put this twisted corner that I imagine was here back to where it started, and then undo this back to the bottom. And here's just another example, but to UBR. So this one is going to go to the top, so that's like this. And then move this to that same spot and move it back down. Then move the side that was yellow to the top now. And then take this one back to where it started and move it back down. Next is how to do three twists. For a three twist in the U layer, I recognize by the OLL, it's either a soon or an anti-soon. Either way, I do OLL into memorizing what U-perm I get. So in this case, I'm gonna do the soon. And then here I know I'm going to do U followed by this angle of this PLL, which goes like this. Afterwards, the AUF is always U prime. For anti-soon, I begin at this angle to do the back-soon alg, which is like this. And then U prime and do this OLL from this hand grip, which goes like this. R3. The AUF is also U prime. I like these because they can both start in home grip, they both start with the OLL, so it's very intuitive, and they both end with U prime, so the AUF is easy as well. Of course, you don't always get it in this angle, but if you get it at an angle, let's say where you had to do U in the beginning, then you just need the total AUF to add up to U prime. For a three twist in D, you just do the beginner method. So this would be like two sexy moves here, and then move on to the next one and do it again. For the buffer and two D pieces, what you can do is two commutators. The first one has to go from yellow to yellow, and the second one goes from the bottom of the one you just picked to the non-yellow side of the first target. You can go in either order, so you could also choose this, this, followed by this, this. I usually just pick the closer one to go to first, so I would do it like this. And the next commutator is this, this. For the buffer and a U and D piece, what I do is again two commutators. The first one goes from the top to the non-yellow side of the bottom piece, and the second one goes from yellow to white. So in this case, this one would look like this. And then from what was yellow to white. Next, how to do parity plus any number of twists. So first you have to know how to do parity plus a single twist, and what you could do is just the parity algorithm followed by a twist alg, how you normally do this, but instead it's faster to link the parity target to other targets here and change to a different parity target at the end. An example of what you could do here is this parity goes to N, I have a twist here, and I could then add F followed by D, because F belongs at D. Or instead, you could do ND followed by I, because this one does belong here, or NI followed by F. It's good to know the general rule of how this goes, where the white can go to the top, or the top can go to the non-white, or the non-white can go to the white. And it's the same idea for D targets. This goes here, this goes here, and this goes here. Once you know that, out of the three options, you can just pick whichever one you'd like to do, and I'll just show you the ones I generally go for. For a parity plus D twist, I like to go parity target to yellow, because it's easy to visualize, and then go from there to the bottom. For parity and U twist, I like to go from parity to the top, because these comms tend to be good, and then followed by the non-white side for parity. If there's a 2 twist that is not independent from the rest of the cube, like I can't just twist these two to solve them, then I do parity to the one on the bottom first before the one on the top. So for the bottom piece, I will always go from non-yellow to yellow. Then I'll go to the top, followed by the side that's not white. The reason I do it this specific way is because the second commutator is forced to be a good one. For parity and a 2 twist in D that is, again, not an independent pair of twists, what I'll do is parity to the side of either one of these, so let's say this one, and then I'll go to each of the yellows. And that's the commutator I force here to be a good one. And lastly, I'll go to the bottom. For parity and a 2 twist in U, I'll usually just do the parity target followed by the 3 twist alloc for this, which is the soon or anti-soon thing I talked about earlier. The reason I do that is because I have to think fast during this and I want at least something to be intuitive, but normally when there's two U layer comms, it's not that intuitive, or at least it's not for me, so I just prefer to do parity followed by one alloc. And lastly, for parity followed by any twist that is independent, as in I can twist both of these without affecting the rest of the cube, then I'll just do the twist and then do parity afterwards. You'll notice a common theme I'm trying to do in all of these, which is to push the parity target to the very end instead of doing parity followed by twists. By trying to force parity to be at the end, sometimes it's more move efficient and sometimes it's about the same number of moves, but parity algs may often end in a different grip than usual, so it's good to leave those for the end to avoid regrips. Next is two edge flips. I explained this one in the previous video as two comms, but there's a cancellation, and so instead I like to think about it like this, which is really similar to corners. Take one side of the edge here and move it up to there, move the flipped one in as well, and then move this one back down. Then take the other side of this and move it up, take the flipped edge back, and then move this back down. Then of course for something like this, it's the exact same idea. You just move this edge this way instead to move it in, and then just go through the rest. This concept even applies to E-layer plus DF or DB, so for something like this, it's just an M' setup. So you would do M' and then just solve this case normally, and cancel the last move. A few of the other cases will fall into a category like this. So here I have these two flipped, and what I'll do is a commutator from here to here, followed by the flip side of this one, and back to the first one. So that's the general idea. You could choose any two first targets. So for example, I could go from here to here, followed by flipping this one, and then back to the first one. Although out of those options, one will be better than the others, and that's this, this, followed by this, this, which looks like this. And then there are cases like this, which you could do the same way. So here, I would go from here to here, followed by flipping this one and back to the first one. Although doing this from the UF buffer is slower than doing it from the UL buffer. So you could think of this as two UL comms, or you could just memorize the whole thing, which would be like this. So I pretty much showed the main ideas that cover a lot of the cases, but there's still going to be some memorization involved. I just learned these slowly, picking up one little category of cases every few days, and I eventually learned all of it. Next, we have something that rarely comes up, but that's a four flip for edges. I pretty much only know two. The first is any variant of this algorithm, and that flips these two and these two. And you can also do variants of this that all do different sorts of flips. The other one I know is a four flip in U, which goes like this. You won't often see four flipped edges, but if you do see three, then you know the buffer is flipped, and then you can just set all these up into the most convenient algorithm for them. In this case, I can put them on the U layer with something like L'S, do the flip, and then undo the setup moves. So we talked about how to flip or twist a ton of pieces at once, but now we're going to talk about how to flip or twist only one, but save a lot of moves doing it. This is breaking into a flipped edge. I'll only show it for edges, but you could apply the exact same concept to corners. So how I would solve something like this normally is this would go to M, which goes to E, then I have a flipped edge and do this to flip at the end. So this would be a commutator plus a flip, and if you watched the previous video, you know that that's slower than two commutators. So instead, this whole thing can be solved with two commutators, and here's how it's done. This is supposed to go to M followed by E, but instead of doing that, I'm going to do M followed by any target here. So for example, I could do ML, and then afterwards I go to the other side of this, which is F, and then the other side of my second target, which is now D. So instead of ME, it's now MD with these two in between. So that would look something like this, ML, and then FD. So anytime you have only one flipped edge, you can save it for your last commutator and do two commutators instead to solve the flip. There's another way you can break into flipped edges that may be easier to think about, but you can only use it sometimes. So if I do memorization for this ignoring the flipped edge, I would get something like this. This goes to E, which is the buffer, and then I can pick A as my new cycle, and then this goes to B, which goes to A. Notice that the new cycle began on the second letter in a pair. So instead of doing E then A, since a cycle break happened here, I can put anything in between and I'll add J and P. So instead of EA, I could do something like EP followed by JA. So that would look like this. That's EP and then JA. And then lastly, the thing that comes after is still the same. The reason I say the second method is easier to think about is because you only add in two targets and you don't change any of your previous targets. But you can't always do it because there has to not only be a cycle break, but it has to be in the middle of a pair. So I find myself using the first option more often, which is leaving it for the last commutator, which takes a lot of thinking at first, but you'll definitely get used to it. And next we have the advanced technique that all the blinders have been crazy about the last few years, and that is floating buffer. So here's an edges example. The idea of floating buffer is when your buffer is solved, you pick a different buffer. In this case, I just have a three cycle, which can be solved with one algorithm. But without floating buffer, I would use an extra algorithm. For example, I'd memorize A, then T, then JA. So AT, and then JA. You can't use floating buffers every solve, and to know when you can use it, you have to meet a few requirements. First, there has to be a cycle break or a new cycle somewhere in the solve. Also, the new cycle has to happen between two letter pairs. It cannot happen in the middle of a letter pair. And lastly, during the cycle break, your buffer has to be solved and not flipped. Here's an example of when you can use floating buffer. So this memorization here, this goes to D, which goes to B. Now, after I get here, I realize that this is the buffer, so I have a cycle break. Also, this happened at the end of the letter pair and not midway through. And lastly, I'm pointing at white and not the green, which means that this is going to go to the buffer, which means that this is going to be solved. So I've met all three requirements, and that means I can do floating buffer next. So then I pick my next buffer and just memorize that goes to F and then J. So I can do DB from my UF buffer, and then I can do FJ from my UB buffer. Now, how would you go about learning the commutators for this? You might be thinking, oh my god, I just learned, or maybe I'm about to learn three style from this buffer, and now I have to learn it from this, and this, and this, and this, and every single buffer. Yes, you'll end up knowing it all, but no, it doesn't take as much work as you might think. So the reason I showed UB as the one I floated to is because, like, besides the fact that that's the only one I know so far, it's also because UB is really good, because it's just like the mirror of UF. So if you know how to do UF, you already know most of UB. For example, something like PD, so if this is the buffer, you would just go PD and then move this one over. And so this commutator is basically a free one. And something like VL, how this is done is just by moving the buffer to here. So from UF, it would look like this. And from UB, it would look like this. That's almost the same. Of course, there are always going to be cases where you just learn an algorithm or it's an exception to the rule, but most of the cases are going to be pretty similar from UB. UL and UR are less similar, but still very similar. And then as you start moving through, you're going to get to harder cases. But if you do learn full floating, like as you go along the way, you're going to end up picking up so much knowledge that when you get to the harder ones, it's going to make that much easier. Oh, also you can do floating for corners, but I've never done it in a solve because I find it to be harder than edges. And I can't use it as often as edges because for the corner buffer to be solved is less likely than for an edge buffer to be solved. So that's kind of an intro tutorial to floating, not super comprehensive because I don't do floating very much, but I have done it in some solves and I'm starting to get good with UB. Remember to check the three style learning sheet in the description for everything three style related that I've already taught. It's very hard to remember it all from a video and it's probably going to take many repetitions of reviewing that sheet. All right, thanks for watching and I'll see you guys next time.